In this video, I'm going to share the 20 items that have sold for the highest profit in the last year of reselling. Stay tuned.
Won't nobody love you the way they should. Won't nobody check up on you, make sure you're good. Won't nobody check those body cameras by your neck. All they really
Hey everyone, my name is Becky Park and I am a part-time reseller on Poshmark, eBay, and Mercari. And in this video, I'm going to share with you my 20 highest Poshmark sales within the last like a little less than a year. I just went back to like last October. And the reason I wanted to do this video is because if you're anything like me, your business model is made up of mainly bread and butter items. And what I mean by that is most of the items in your closet sell under $50 and they sell pretty quickly. People have different brands that they consider bread and butter, but for me, I consider those brands to be things like American Eagle, Loft, Anthropology. I can't think of any others right now off the top of my head, but they're brands that you're able to find pretty consistently at the thrift store or wherever else it is that you go sourcing. And they're items that you pick up for a pretty reasonable price, knowing that you're probably gonna be able to flip those items and get $20 to $30 if you're lucky for those pieces. That's the business model that I have, and that comes from the fact that I live in an area where I just don't have access to a lot of the higher end brands. I also don't have a lot of time to do online arbitrage, and honestly, the retail arbitrage opportunities in my town are pretty limited and not as amazing as what I know other people have access to. Not only that, but I also really enjoy thrifting. Like, I love going to just Goodwill or Salvation Army and seeing what I can find. The problem is most of the time I'm not finding stuff that's gonna bring in $100, $200. Now, I'm not saying that my business model is correct, as I know that there are a lot of resellers out there who really don't pick up items unless they know that they can make at least $50 on it. That's not me. I'm okay with making $2 here, $10 here, a random $100 here, but to each their own. One reason I wanted to make this video, however, is just so that you can get an idea of what kinds of things do sell for a higher amount, so anything $50 or more. And these are items that I have been able to find here in my kind of more rural area. Some of the items I may have thrifted in like the Chicagoland area, but I think really there's only like one or two pieces that were thrifted outside of Champaign-Urbana, which is where I live. So I wanted to just give you an idea of what kinds of things you may even still be able to find regardless of where you live, and just brands to look out for, things to look out for while you're thrifting. A lot of these might be pretty self-explanatory and you probably have heard of these brands or know a lot about them, but in case you don't, I just wanted to make sure that you could keep your eyes out for these while you were out thrifting. So in this video, I'm going to share what sold, how much it sold for, where I found it, and anything else that you might need to know about that item. All right, so let's get right into it. The latest thing that sold for $50 or more in my closet was this men's Moncler embroidered logo t-shirt, and it had patches on the sleeves as well with the brand, I don't remember. It was in a size large and I sold it for $56. I did pick this up at a local Goodwill. I just happened to see it in the t-shirt section. I thought it looked kind of interesting, and when I looked at the tag and saw that it was Moncler, I knew that it was probably a good pickup, and I'm glad that I got it because it sold for $56 pretty quickly. I want to say within a week or two of listing it. The second thing that I sold for over $50 was this pair of John Fluvog Blind Faith Molly Leather pumps in a size 9.5. These shoes I actually picked up at a pop-up consignment sale that happens twice a year in my town. Basically, there are people who sign up to run the event in any given town, and they organize people to come in and consign their pieces. There's this whole system of like pricing your items, and you create these price tags for it. Our event is held at a local church, and I've gone for the past, I want to say, 3 times that they've had this sale now. And every time I always come out with a good number of items. It's kind of like going to the thrift store, except rather than being able to find only like one or two pieces to resell per rack, you find one every like 10 pieces or so, because there is a standard set of what you're allowed to consign. And one of my favorite sections to hit up at this consignment sale are the shoes. Sometimes they are priced pretty high, but there are also a lot of shoes that are very reasonably priced, and they always go on the last day when it's half off of most things. So when I went to the sale for the half off day, the last time that the sale was happening in my town, I saw these John Fluvog pumps and they were marked at $50. Now, they were marked as being half off, so I knew that for me they would only be $25 on that day, but I still just like wasn't sure if they were a good pickup. I had heard people talk about John Fluvog on Instagram and different places like that, but I just wasn't sure if it was gonna be a good pickup, so I actually left the sale and went home. And the hard thing was, at the sale, I have very limited service. In fact, I just like don't have service inside that church. So I can't ever really look up comps. I just have to go off of my gut. And I have made a few mistakes, you know, throughout the three times that I've gone. I have brought home duds, but I didn't want to take a risk on $25 shoes, so I left them. And then when I got home, the first thing that I did was check the comps, and I was like, oh my gosh, like I see that some of these have sold between like the $75 and $100 range. So I told my husband that I needed to go back, and I did. And thankfully they were still there. So I brought them home, listed them, and within like a week or two of having them listed, someone bought them at my full asking price of $90. What? Crazy. So if you see John Fluvog, definitely pick them up if you can get them for a decent price. I paid $25 for mine and it was still well worth it. John Fluvog is a Canadian brand and you don't find a lot of his shoes here in America, which is why I think that they're even more sought after if you can find them here. Let me just take a moment right here too, since I did mention Instagram, to let you know that if you aren't following me on Instagram yet, you can follow me at Becky Park on Poshmark. You can also check out my Poshmark closet if you want to see what kinds of things I'm selling over there, how I'm pricing things, what my pictures look like, etc., etc. My closet name is simply Becky Park. And if you like this video and you want to see more content like it, don't forget to hit the like button as well as subscribe if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet. Anyways, let's keep going. The third thing to sell for $50 or more was this new without tags Samsonite leather flap briefcase with a key. This was actually given to me for free by a friend of my brother's who knows that I resell. And I think that he was moving and he just had all this stuff that he needed to just like donate or let go of. So my brother found out that he had all this stuff. And so my brother came home one day with like bags of stuff for me from his friend, which was really nice. And in one of those bags was this briefcase by Samsonite. Samsonite itself is a great brand. And this particular briefcase was pretty cool because, like I said, it did have this like little key that you could use to actually lock the briefcase, and I saw that the key was still attached to the briefcase on the inside. And it was clear to me that this briefcase had never actually been used, and my brother's friend said that it was just kind of like too big and bulky for him to carry around with him to work every day. There were a few little wear marks like on the corners from when it had been stored, but someone sent me an offer of $50 on this bag, and I accepted. I think that I had it listed around like $60-$65, but I thought $50 was fair. So every penny that I earned on that bag was pure profit because it was given to me for free. And this is one of those items that I feel like if I'd seen it at a thrift store, I feel like I would have passed on it because I just don't know very much about briefcases or about Samsonite items in general. So I'm glad that someone gave it to me for free and I was able to try it out with no risk, and the reward was huge. The next thing that we'll talk about is also a men's piece, and it is this vintage Burberry wool V-neck golf sweater. It was in this kind of like minty green color, and I found it in the boutique section of one of the Goodwills in my town, but it was only marked at like $6.99. And furthermore, I feel like maybe it was half off that week. I don't remember. Regardless of if I paid $7 or $3.50 for it, it's still Burberry. Like, it was still a good pickup. And even though it was vintage, like, you could tell it was older because the tag was that older Burberry tag. So I didn't really know what to do with it. The comps were kind of all over the place, but I went ahead and listed it pretty high, and within like a month of having it listed, someone sent me an offer of $53, which I happily accepted, and that was a fun sale. It was my first time finding Burberry out in the wild, and it did not disappoint. Next up, this was kind of interesting and shocking to me, to say the least. I have heard a lot of people, a lot of resellers talk about Cache, C-A-C-H-E. I don't believe that this brand is in existence anymore. It was a really popular brand in the 90s. It was a mall brand, but like a higher end mall brand. And they sold a lot of like fancier dresses, kind of like cocktail dresses or things that you would wear to weddings and whatnot, kind of for a more mature woman. And so a lot of people will pick up Cache pieces because they believe that they're pretty desirable given the fact that this brand doesn't exist anymore. So I followed suit as a reseller and I've picked up multiple Cache dresses, many of which have not yet sold, and they have been in my Poshmark closet for over a year. Now, that being said, this particular dress, I think I picked it up at that same pop-up consignment sale, and it was this 100% silk beaded deep V-neck dress in a size 6. I think the fact that it was 100% silk helped, and I think the fact that it was beaded helped a lot too. So I actually sold this dress for $50, which is, like I said, pretty uncommon for me when it comes to cachet pieces, because most of them I can't even give away, and the few that I have sold haven't really sold for that much, nothing close to $50. So that was a surprising sale and a good one, to say the least. So if you do come across cachet in your thrift store or at a garage sale or something, I would say just be really mindful of, do you think that today's woman would want to wear that? Because it is an older brand, so these pieces are a bit older, and if it looks just too old school, it's not really fashionable or trendy now, I would leave it. But this particular dress, I could see people wearing even today, and it was made of 100% silk. I think that that helps a lot too. Look at the material content and see if it's made of good fabric, and if so, it might be worth picking up. The next thing that I'll talk about is this pair of Newith Tags Anthropology Mave Metallic Brocade pants with this really pretty floral print in a size 10. They sold for $85, which I was thrilled with, and I think that that was my full asking price as well. Now, I did have these listed for a little bit longer, I want to say around 2 months, and I had picked them up at a Goodwill. I want to say that this is the one item that I picked up at a Goodwill that wasn't in my town. It was in a Chicago suburb, like a southern Chicago suburb. So it was in a more affluent area than my town for sure, which is why I think I found them there. They were Newith Tags, and I initially thought that the Goodwill tag said that they were like $1.99, but I think they were actually $10.99. So when I paid for them, I was like, oh, this is much more than I thought it was gonna be. But I was still okay paying $10.99 for them because they were Newith Tags, and the retail price was something ridiculous, like $189, or I don't even remember. It was really, really high. So I listed them for right around like $99 initially, but after some time I dropped the price to $85 when they weren't selling, and they didn't really get that many likes or anything either, but finally they did sell at the full asking price of the time for $85, so that was a good sale. Definitely, I think a lot of people have found that they're having a hard time moving certain Anthropology pieces, and I am definitely not immune to that as well. I have a lot of Anthropology that's just sitting around in my closet collecting dust because there's a lot of it online, and a lot of people are selling it for really cheap now. But I think that if you can find things that are pretty unique or have very interesting qualities to them or are new with tags, I think that they are definitely much more marketable, and people are going to be willing to pay a little bit more for them for that. So I'm not going to stop picking up Anthropology because, to be honest, I don't find a whole lot of it in my area, and every time I do, I still get really excited. But definitely either be pickier about what you pick up or be more realistic about how much you're gonna actually get for those pieces. This next item that I'm gonna talk about was actually really surprising to me because of where I got them. So it's this pair of Vince Mules. They were called the Levens, and they were made of Italian leather, and they were just kind of this like tan sand colored mule in a size 8.5. I sold them for $60. I don't remember exactly what I paid for them, but it was definitely under $5. I even want to say under $4. I found them at this thrift store in my town that I usually have no luck with. Like, I don't even really go there anymore because every time I go, I tend to leave empty-handed, or I leave with one or two items that I just didn't even really need to pick up in the first place because they're not that awesome. But I went there for whatever reason on a whim, and that day that I went, I found such good stuff, and I think that I just got really lucky because someone had donated some really great things and they didn't know what they had. So I found these pair of mules in the shoe section and was just like thrilled because I don't ever find Vince. Like, Vince is so hard for me to find in my area, and I sold them for $60. I'll take it any day. Since then, I have gone back to that thrift store, and it continues to be pretty garbage. But I will continue to pop in there here and there just in case that same person decides to donate more of her Vince stuff. Next up, I sold this men's Banana Republic wool cashmere blend pea coat in a size small for $50. And this actually happened to be my husband's. My husband used to wear this back when I don't know, maybe even before we were married. So it's definitely more than like 10 years old, I want to say. But the nice thing about Banana Republic is that their pieces are so classy that they're really timeless. So it doesn't matter if you buy it today or if you bought it 10 years ago, it's still something that you're going to be able to wear. So my husband didn't really like it anymore because it was more of a looser fit and he's more into like that slim fit now. So he was like, hey, if you want to sell this, you can. I listed it, immediately got a lot of attention on it, a lot of likes and things like that, and someone finally sent me an offer of $50, which is pretty cool because that's something that my husband wore for many years, and then we were able to sell it and make $50 off of it. Next up, we have this vintage Judith Ann Creations scalloped flapper two-piece shirt and skirt outfit. This was very interesting because it's something that my mother-in-law just happened to have in her house for ages. And when my husband and I had a garage sale, I don't know, it must have been 6 or 7 years ago. He just turned the shower on, so if you heard a crazy noise, that's what that was. But we had a garage sale like 6 or 7 years ago, and she brought all this stuff from her house to add to our garage sale, and she brought three pieces by this brand, Judith Ann Creations. And they were all 100% silk and heavily beaded. They each weigh like 8 pounds or something. Like, they're just crazy. They're like super ornate. Anyway, she gave us three of these pieces. They did not sell at the garage sale, and I think I did price them high for like garage sale prices. I had them priced at like $25 or something. And on top of that, they're kind of like costume clothes. You know what I mean? Like, people are not wearing this out and about every single day. So I can see why they didn't sell at the garage sale. These were also not quick flips. Like, I've definitely had all three of those pieces listed for well over a year before I sold any of them. And in fact, I still have one of those outfits, the last one, left in my closet, and it's been more than a year and a half at this point. So they're not quick flips, but if you do come across anything by Judith Ann Creations, and if they are heavily beaded with sequins and beads and whatnot the way that these pieces are, you may have something special on your hands. I would also suggest if you find anything by Judith Ann Creations, maybe try selling them over on like Tradesy or Etsy or eBay, just somewhere where you can get more eyes on them. I think part of the reason why they sat so long in my closet too is because Poshmark is not really known for selling vintage wear. So, you know, if I had tried selling them on other platforms, maybe they would have sold for possibly more, but definitely, I think, faster. But I still made, what is it, $74 on this outfit, and I was really happy with that. Here is another example of a brand that I just don't find very often where I live, but I did find this dress at a local Goodwill, and it was this dress by Aritzia by the brand Babaton, and it was the Bennett dress in this teal color, and it is 100% silk. It was in the size extra, extra small, so yes, even small sizes can sell well too, and I sold it for $50. Aritzia is such a great brand. People love Aritzia, and I don't feel like it's oversaturated yet on platforms like Poshmark or eBay or Mercari. So if you see Babaton, which sometimes it's called T Babaton, or Wilfrid Free, those brands, they tend to do really well on Poshmark. This next item was also not sourced in my town, but it was sourced like maybe a few towns over. It was like a 45-minute drive. It was not an affluent town by any means. It's probably a little bit bigger of a town than where I live right now in Champaign-Urbana. I picked it up while I was on a conference with some students. They were at a music festival and I had some downtime, so I went thrifting. And I found this really interesting jacket by the brand Sessions. It was the Truth jacket, and it was this snowboarding jacket with like stripes on it, really brightly colored. It had never been worn before. You could tell this thing was brand new and just someone decided not to use it for whatever reason. And it was a size large. I think it was a men's large, but I can't remember now. Anyway, it sold for $68, again, within like a couple weeks of listing it. I think that $68 was my asking price, so someone just flat out bought it. I had never heard of the brand Sessions before, but this jacket just stood out to me at the thrift store because it was so bright and it just looked like it was really well made. I think that when you find articles of clothing for specialized things like sports or, you know, specific events, I think that they have the potential to sell really well. So this was a jacket specifically designed for snowboarders in mind, and I think that that's one of the reasons why it sold for such a high amount, because there aren't as many brands out there that cater just to the snowboarding community. And if you're looking for something as an avid snowboarder, you're gonna look for something from one of the brands that you know and trust when it comes to your given sport. So you know, definitely keep your eye out for even those types of items, even if you're not super familiar with them. It's not like I know a whole lot about snowboarding, but I just recognized that this was a well-made item. I looked at my comps and I knew that I should pick it up, even though I do think I paid up for it. I think I paid like $10 for it, but I knew that it would be worth it. Next up, I found this pair of New Without Tags Driftwood Jackie skinny embroidered jeans. I found them at my local Goodwill. They were just hanging out, gorgeous pair of jeans. I don't remember why I knew Driftwood was a good brand. I think that, again, I'd seen it on someone's Instagram page, but when I ran the comps, one, I saw that there were not very many listed, and two, I saw that the ones that had sold for a good amount. I listed mine pretty high, but they still sold for full asking price of $75, again, within like weeks of listing them. So if you find Driftwood, I would definitely recommend picking it up. I don't remember where Driftwood is sold. I think I saw some people say Buckle, but I don't think that that's right. I got my information about these jeans from the Driftwood website because they have their own website and they don't have that many cuts of jeans yet. And so that's how I was able to find out what this jean was called, how much it was priced originally. And I did use that information as well as comps from Poshmark when pricing my item. The next item is also something that I just thrifted at a Goodwill, and it was this Amour Vert. I don't know how to say that. It sounds French. Amour Vert. And it was the Clemence herringbone jacket in a size large. Again, you could tell that it had never been worn. It was brand new. The tag was still like crispy. It sold for $50. Its asking price was really high. It was like over $100, $200. I don't remember what, but I had it listed pretty high to begin with. I think I had it listed at like $99, and I wasn't getting a lot of action on it, so I gradually kept moving the price down. This item did take a little bit longer to sell, and I think it's because of the fact that I had it priced way too high to begin with, but it did finally sell. I believe someone sent me an offer for $50. I initially thought that maybe this brand was Anthropologie. It was not. Amour Vert. I can't say it, but that brand, it has like its own website, and that's how I was able to find the name of this particular jacket. But they do some really nice high-end pieces. It does seem like a lot of their pieces are desirable and sought after. I'm not gonna sneeze at $50, especially when I probably had like $6 into this. If you see this brand, I definitely recommend picking it up. The next item we're gonna talk about, I believe, is also from the consignment pop-up sale that I picked up some of these other pieces from. It's probably from like the first or second one that I went to. And it was actually a men's piece, which this consignment pop-up is not supposed to carry men's pieces, but someone snuck one in there, and I'm glad that they did because I found it and I picked it up. It was this rag and bone black button-up jacket with four pockets in a size large, and I sold it for $65. I did hold on to it for quite some time, but eventually it did sell for $65. It was made of this really interesting material. We have another vintage Judith Ann beaded piece, and this one is more of like a cardigan or even like a jacket, but it was open front, and this one was gorgeous. I honestly would have probably tried to wear this if it wasn't so big. The only thing about these pieces, however, is that they are so heavy. But this one finally sold for $94, and this was the first Judith Ann piece to sell. And this one sold at full asking price of $94. I did initially have these pieces priced, all of them, above like $100, $150, but I had gradually started dropping the price with, you know, each closet clear out. And when it hit $94, someone did finally buy it at that price. I did get a decent number of offers on this particular piece. I got offers as low as like $20 and as low as $60, but I knew I just needed to wait for the right buyer who would appreciate the crap out of it. And finally someone came along and paid the $94 and was really happy with it. So I'm glad that I listened to my gut and didn't let it go for less. A lot of times I feel like I do let go of things, but I just knew that this was really special and that it needed to go to the right person. Another thing that sold for $50 was this new in the box, or new with tags, Nike Plus Fuel Band watch tracker in a size medium large in the color black. It was kind of Nike's take on like the Fitbit or, you know, the Apple Watch or whatever, and it's pretty old. My husband actually got this for standing in one of his friend's weddings. His friend gave it to all of the groomsmen, and my husband doesn't really wear watches or anything on his wrist really, so it just sat in the box forever and ever and ever. And finally I just like saw it one day and I was like, I'm gonna try listing this over on my Poshmark closet. I did have it listed for a pretty long time. time, and then finally someone bought it at $50. I think that, if I remember correctly, the person who ended up buying this sent me a pretty lowball offer, and we went back and forth quite a bit until we finally landed at $50. He gave me a 1-star rating saying that it didn't work, which I personally find kind of hard to believe, just because my husband never used it. It just sat in the box, and if anything, maybe it didn't work because maybe you needed to put like a battery in it or something, or charge it. I don't know. Regardless, I still got my money, so I don't really care when it comes to low ratings. And that's actually a video that's gonna come up, are just like low ratings or cases that are opened up against you and different lessons that I've learned. But it didn't really bother me that I only got a 1-star rating on it, because I still got my money, and yeah. We only have a few pieces left. So this next one was by the brand Black Halo, and it was the Jackie jumpsuit in a size 10, and it was missing the belt. This sucker still sold for $85. We got this at the Bins in Seattle when I went to visit my parents last summer in 2018. All I wanted to do when we went to Seattle was go to the Bins, because I heard that thrifting in Seattle in general is just like amazing, because you just have a lot of people with a lot of money. So all I wanted to do was go thrifting, especially go to the Bins. And so finally there was like one day where my husband and I were able to sneak away for like an hour maybe, which meant that after you take out the time that it took to get there and back, we had maybe like 30 minutes. So we went to one of the Bins. We went late in the evening when it was about to close anyway, and they still had so much good stuff, like so much good stuff. They had great shoes. They had just like so much amazing stuff. And the really annoying thing was that we only had like our carry-on bags, so I couldn't get any of the shoes. We couldn't get a lot of stuff because we knew that we had very limited space when it came to, you know, taking all of this stuff back home. But the funny thing is, I saw this jumpsuit and it did have some pilling and stuff. In fact, it had a lot of pilling. And I saw that it was missing the belt, and I didn't know that Black Halo was such a desirable brand when I saw it. So I remember picking it up, and I think maybe I did look up comps to it, but I just looked up Halo, which there is a brand called Halo, and it's not as good of a brand, nearly as good of a brand as Black Halo. So I threw it back. And then when my husband and I got back together and were like sorting through our stuff, he had that jumpsuit in his hand, and I was like, oh, I threw that back. And he's like, why? I just looked up comps and they're like so high. And I was like, what are you talking about? So we looked at comps again together, and when you type in Black Halo, that's when you see, holy cow, these things go for a lot. Like, were this in better condition, I probably could have gotten well over $100 for it. But because it was missing its belt and there was some pilling and whatnot, the fact that I was still able to get $85 for it, and that was within like a few days of me listing it, I mean, that tells you how popular this brand is. So if you find Black Halo, snatch it up right away. The next item is another Bins find, but we found this at the Indianapolis Bins, and this was last year when we went. It is this J. Crew wool cashmere blend dark olive pea coat, and it was a women's pea coat. And I don't remember what the size was. It'll show here. It was a larger size though. This was another one of those that my husband and I, we just kind of like debated, because again, there was a lot of pilling and there was some issues with it, and it was heavy. So, you know, when you're at the Bins and you're paying by the pound, you do have to account for the fact that jackets like this that are close to like 3-4 pounds, they're gonna cost you a little bit more. But we decided to take the risk, and I'm glad that we did, because it sold for $65, which I think was full asking price. Next up was another item that was my husband's. He had actually picked up two of these Patagonia Better Sweater full zip jackets. He picked up two of them when they went on sale at this local outdoorsy store that we have. And he just decided that he didn't really like the color. He had it for a while and never found himself reaching for it. So he was like, I'm gonna let it go. He had never taken the tags off or anything, so the fact that it was new with tags too, I think helped this sell. It only sold for $76. I thought that it would sell for more, but we still ended up making like a tiny bit of profit on it because of how good that sale was. The store wasn't going out of business, but they were having like a we're moving location sale, so it was a really good sale. But $76 on that. Patagonia still sells really well. I do think that the market is a little bit more saturated, so you know, you do need to be a little bit more selective about what Patagonia you pick up, but the Better Sweater jackets, like, you can't really go wrong with. So if you find those, I definitely recommend picking them up. The last thing that we will talk about is this piece that I picked up when my students at school were doing a garage sale to raise money to go to New York. For that garage sale, one of my students' moms went to Michigan to kind of clean out her mom's closet and came back with like a U-Haul full of stuff. And a lot of the clothes that this woman wore was a lot of like art to wear and just more high-end brands that aren't really that well known. Her mom and I decided that I would sell them in my Poshmark closet because I would definitely make more on those items than we would at our garage sale. And then I just added those items up and made sure to send the money over to my school. So this was one of those items by the brand Babette SF. SF, I believe, stands for San Francisco because this was a San Francisco-based brand, and this brand doesn't exist anymore. But this particular jacket was made of an alpaca blend, which is when I knew that it was probably pretty good, and it was in this violet color, and it was in a size petite, which generally is like extra small. It sold for $100, which I think was below my asking price, but it was still a really good offer, so I accepted it. And the person was really happy with the jacket, so that was really exciting. Again, I probably would have passed had I seen this at the thrift store because I'd never heard of the brand. It looked a little like mature and not really the type of thing that I tend to pick up, but I'm really glad that I had the opportunity to learn about this brand by having this student's mom pick it up and bring it to me and basically tell me, this is good, try to sell it. So, of those 20 items that sold for $50 or more, I'm gonna tell you right now, I had to go all the way back to last October to find 20 pieces that sold for $50 or more. I did have a couple boutique pieces that sold at $50, but I didn't wanna include those in this list because those aren't pieces that you can like find in the wild. They are kind of exclusive to me because they're boutique pieces. That being said, that just goes to show how seldomly, is that a word, seldomly? How seldom? How infrequently I find pieces that sell for $50 or more. It just doesn't happen very often. For some of you watching this video, this is your business model. You only sell things that are $50 or more, and that's amazing. I applaud you. I'm honestly kind of jealous of you, and that's awesome. Like, yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. However, if I were to try to run a business model like that, then I would have very few sales because I just don't have a lot of those kinds of items. It's not for lack of trying. I definitely always try to look for these kinds of things, but it's either a lack of knowledge of knowing what kinds of things to pick up. Like I said, some of these brands I didn't really even know about unless they were like thrust on me. Like in the case of those Judith Ann Creations pieces, I definitely would not have picked those up at the thrift store by myself. But because they were given to me, I just happened to list them and go through the process of looking up comps and whatnot. And it's because of that that I was able to realize, one, this sells for a good amount, and two, I was able to get that amount. All that to say, while it is always amazing to have those days where you are making some big sales, they are pretty far and few in between. And so there's no shame in that bread and butter game where you are selling a whole ton of Loft, a whole ton of Abercrombie, a whole ton of Express and what have you, because those are the items that will pay the bills. Those are the items that bring in consistent sales, and there's no shame in that. Now, in regards to these 20 items, I wanted to just break it down so that you have an idea of what kinds of items are selling for $50 or more, at least in my closet. Of the 20 items I just shared with you today, 12 of them were women's pieces and 8 of them were men's pieces. So it's definitely not exclusive to a gender. Now, none of them are children's pieces. I think it's a little bit harder to find children's pieces that are gonna get you that much money, but that's not to say that it's impossible. Of those 20 pieces, 9 of them were thrifted at a typical thrift store type situation. 2 of them were purchased at consignment stores, and I think they were actually both purchased at the same pop-up consignment store. So that just goes to show too, like perhaps in order to find these pieces that are gonna bring you a higher dollar amount, maybe you have to look at consignment stores. But in my case, thrift stores work just as well too. 3 of them were given to me by either a family or a friend. 3 of them were just from our own home. It was just stuff that my husband didn't wear anymore or never used. 2 of them were found at the bins, and 1 was purchased at a garage sale. Of the 20 pieces, 8 of them were jackets. And that makes sense. Jackets in general are more expensive to begin with, and they command a higher dollar amount. So if you really want to look for things that are going to bring you a higher dollar amount, I suggest looking at jackets because people are willing to pay more money for them. I know it seems crazy with it being like summertime right now, but it's not a bad time to think about picking up jackets, because very soon here, people are gonna start thinking about the fall and the winter and picking up their pieces for those seasons. So if you can get a head start on finding jackets to sell, why not? And one thing to note too about some of the jackets that did sell for over $50, they were by brands like J. Crew and Banana Republic. Typically for a Banana Republic shirt, let's say, I can't get more than like $20, but because it's a jacket, it's gonna bring in some more money. The rest of the items were distributed pretty evenly throughout other categories, such as dresses, there were three of them in this list of 20 pieces, and then tops and shoes, there were two a piece of those, and everything else, there was one in their category. So like there was one bag that sold, one pair of pants, one pair of jeans, one accessory, and one jumpsuit. So ideally, it looks like if you're gonna be selling things for top dollar, it's gonna be something like a jacket. That's it for my video today. I hope you guys enjoyed it. And if you enjoy content like this, please hit the like button so that I know that you enjoy content like this. I try to upload at least 2 videos a week. So if you're interested in following me on my reselling journey, make sure that you hit the subscribe button. And you can even press that little bell just so that you're notified every time I upload another video. Thank you guys so much. I hope you learned a little bit more about some brands that will hopefully bring in top dollar for you, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!